four Pevensies are called back to Narnia in order to try and help Prince Caspian save it from the wicked hands of King Miraz. And I think, you know, this in the last movie, Susan was very much unaccepting of the fact that they were in Narnia. She couldn't cope with it. She didn't want to believe in it. So the journey was very much one of belief. And this time round, it's more about the fact that she knows Narnia exists, but the last time she sort of got used to it, she was ripped away from it and taken back to being a schoolgirl. So I think that this time there's more of that kind of underlying fear of like, oh, I don't want to commit to it in case someone takes me away from it again. I think a lot of people are quite kind of anti-Susan because she's very much the voice of reason in the first movie. But I kind of sympathise with it. I think, you know, if I walked through a wardrobe into a magical world, I would start to question it. I don't think Susan's quite so cynical this time around because she's been a high queen in Narnia. She knows Narnia happens. But I think she just never quite gets comfortable with the idea that you can be shunted back and forth between the two worlds. And so she doesn't really feel at home or able to kind of happily stay there. I think at the end of the movie where Aslan tells Susan and Peter that, you know, they've done a great job but they're not going to be coming back, it's quite a poignant moment. And yeah, that's probably where all the sort of doubt comes from, really. Well, I think the thing is that we read things with modern eyes. And, you know, while some people would say that the way that C.S. Lewis dealt with Susan in the other books is sexist, I don't know if people reading it at the time would have felt exactly the same thing. I don't think, and in fact, if you read The Magician's Nephew, the way in which he treats Polly and Diggory, I think people kind of take things out of context slightly. And the way in which he treats those characters clearly shows that he doesn't see it as like, oh, girls can't do anything. The nice thing for us is that we have Doug Gresham, who's C.S. Lewis's stepson, kind of on hand, on set a lot, checking that everything's, you know, in order and not too crazy or too different. So any changes that we do make are kind of in order to make a good movie. And they're ones that Doug approves. So in this, a major change for me was that in the book, Susan isn't part of the battle. She's not part of the action. And we've changed that. Susan's involved in the battle. She doesn't wield a sword because C.S. Lewis says that battles are ugly affairs where women fight. But it just seems kind of, it seems sort of, didn't seem to quite fit that in a story where there's such a small army facing huge numbers of Telmarines, they wouldn't use everyone they can get. And Susan's great with a bow and arrow, so why wouldn't she be helping? So yeah, we put that in.